I'll start with a quick visual description. I am a white woman with brown hair and a center parting. I have sparkly silver shoes on, a blue suit, and a walking stick. It's really lovely to be here and see some of you interested in diversity within fashion. Arguably, the community I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about are not represented. So one in four, in the UK have a disability. That is 22% of the global population. And yet in fashion, we are very, very rarely included, not just on a runway, but also in the clothes and the design of those clothes. I'm going to talk a bit about my story and what I have done, and then I'll talk about Unhidden. I'm not going to disclose too much medical information because it's not entirely relevant, but it's not irrelevant either. It's obviously part of my story. So I studied fashion design. I graduated in 2008 and worked predominantly as a pattern cutter and then fell into being a garment technologist, which is kind of like a clothing engineer. And then alongside all of that in 2012, which I think I put here, if the clicker works. There we go. So you'll see March 2012, I didn't have a great month. I had a near-death experience and some life-saving surgery, which led to multiple other surgeries and admissions. But it was during one of those admissions in 2016 that a fellow patient on the ward with me had survived cancer, but she had two stomas, a line in her arm, and was there to be fitted for one in her chest. And she couldn't dress how she wanted to in hospital. She couldn't dress how she wanted to at home or at work. And there was an assumption that she didn't have a job because of all of these conditions, which is why traditionally it's been very difficult for disabled people to find clothing. But it was a light bulb moment and an absolute gift to me to then realize I could use everything I'd learned throughout my career to a better purpose. I did spend quite a lot of time developing it. I went freelance after my last permanent role, which was working on the tailoring of Victoria Beckham. And then I registered Unhidden in 2017. Didn't start trading until 2020, but again, the pandemic, despite the mass disabling event that it was and continues to be, it did give me the time away from clients to actually start to apply everything that I'd learned to adaptive fashion. I did a TED talk last year. I've also been an honoree for the Conscious Fashion Campaign and had my face in Times Square in New York Fashion Week, which was intense and amazing. And I had my first solo debut runway show this February, and I'm currently getting ready for September Fashion Week as well. Trying to click. I also was on Dragon's Den this year. It was absolutely terrifying. This is less scary by far than that. They were wonderful, and it was incredible though, because that was a year ago and they film it so far in advance that the difference between when I did it then to now and where Unhidden is vastly different. We've got partnerships. I've just closed my first investment round, and we've got so many other brands that are engaging with us now, which is truly, truly fantastic because we just haven't had that for so long. Sorry, the clicker doesn't like me. There we go. So I'll talk you through some of the barriers and some of the things that I had to do with Unhidden that made a difference to not just myself, but to the people that I was working with. So I had my first shoot in the two-week window in September of 2020 where you were allowed to meet up with people. And I had 10 models, that most of whom had never modeled before. I just found them on Instagram after doing a shout out. They didn't know what they were coming into, but it was the first time I got to actually engage with people my own age about fashion, wearing my designs, and talking through with them like what worked and what didn't work. It was a really, really powerful moment. And yeah, I still really, like, that photography is still on our website. And to date, it is actually the only photography shoot that I've done because I don't believe in not paying disabled people for their time. And this was the only shoot where I didn't, but they have a lifetime discount from Unhidden, which hopefully makes up for it a bit now. But to make it accessible, sorry, I was trying to change slide while I go. So to make the shoot accessible though, the problem in London in particular, but I think around the world, is accessibility within studios, within photography, within the people that you're working with. Like, it does take a lot of language learning, and a lot of non-disabled people unfortunately don't have the language. I did write a book called The Little Book of Ableism that helps act as a barrier to make it a bit less scary, because disability isn't something to be afraid of. It's not a bad word, but it is really important that we start looking at how we can make fashion inclusive, not just front of house, not just on runways, not just in the clothing, but also behind the scenes. I was non-disabled when I studied fashion, and like 80% of the community, I acquired my disability. So we could almost argue that everyone here is pre-disabled, because at some point you might even just have a temporary disability, like broken arm, or a new parent that can't put down their baby. There are all sorts of things things that can make you be part of this community at any time. And it's important that we start to work towards bringing us all in, because when you bring in creative and diverse brains, then your brand, your company, your lives will be better. A lot of the things that are designed for access were built initially for people with disabilities, and there's something that we all use. Like Alexa was built for people who have visual impairments. We all use Alexa or some version of it to these days. So a case of universal design, it doesn't just benefit people with disabilities, it benefits everybody. So the two pieces up here are some of the best sellers that I have. It's the seated trousers in particular are very much what I call adaptive fashion. So that means they are seated and they are designed, the pattern is designed for a seated position. Whereas universal design, like what I'm wearing here, has accessible things and components in it that you wouldn't necessarily notice. I am going to talk you through them though. So I have elasticated cuffs, which means if you've got a limb difference, you can change and adjust where the sleeve sits. It also opens via snap fastenings in the sleeves. So if you're going through cancer, radiotherapy, have diabetes, you can access your arm without removing your clothes, which is really important in terms of dignity and modesty dressing. And then snap buttons down the front, which also, no buttons, basically. There's very few buttons in and hidden. Bonnie, seen here wearing this dress, it has a hidden zip opening that allows you to access your stoma or a feeding tube or a catheter tube, again, without having to remove your dress, which is a really, really simple thing to do. I have a lot of the time people say to me, is it cost? You know, is that why brands aren't doing adaptive design? It's not cost. We see fashion designers make jackets out of zips entirely, or some of the most expensive and luxurious fabrics there are. Cost is not the reason. Cost is an excuse. And actually, what really helps put this into context is that it's sometimes just a bit of, you know, a bit of elastic. There are quite a few brands that have things that are accidentally adaptive, which they could actually market towards a disabled consumer, because brands definitely have disabled consumers, whether or not they target them, but they should be targeting them. I'll talk a little bit about digital spaces, because we do struggle with this to some degree. So having captions and BSL interpreters is something I would normally have as well. But having captions on your internal communications as well as your external highlights to people that work with you that you're being inclusive, but also to people outside, so your consumers, your elderly consumers, people who are going through something that requires them to have extra access in their clothing, that's how you help them. Alt text, again, really, really simple, and should be, if you're putting any kind of imagery out there anywhere, alt text. You know, Twitter has it as a function now, despite firing the entire accessibility team this year. LinkedIn has it. Threads launched without the ability to have alt text, and something that Meta knows is a problem, and I will complain about Meta a bit more shortly. And video descriptions, which can be super fun. It's another way to be engaging with your consumers and create conversations. So it's not something that people should be overlooking. And it just allows more people to enjoy your work and get your brand and your story out there as well. So then to come on to Meta and digital ableism. So the barriers that I have had hugely with Meta is any time I use an image of a wheelchair user or there is some visible medical item on display on the model, they reject the advert. I'm not allowed to sell that product because the algorithm flags it as me selling healthcare or medical services when I'm selling clothes. It's not quite sophisticated enough to realize that I'm selling clothing, but it's sophisticated enough to flag it, and it only happens on wheelchair users so far. And Meta knows that it's a problem. In 2019, they were caught out saying that disability made people uncomfortable. But they also made the disabled community a protected characteristic in January 2022, which means I cannot target them for marketing, which is something of a problem when that's my demographic. So we've had to be quite creative, but it means not being able to use the language. It sometimes means not being able to actually push our products. We can only use imagery. And it's something that continues to be a problem. And also, because we have to use alt text, we have to use camel casing on our hashtags, which means a capital letter at the beginning of each letter so that it makes sense to someone using a screen reader. Using and doing all of those things reduces our reach. Even just the language that we use reduces our reach. I was in a campaign for Kurt Geiger, and their reach tanked on the stories about me, and they said it also happens whenever they talk about ethnicity, which is a huge problem, and something they know is a problem, but they're just not fixing, and they're not engaging with adaptive brands. There's an adaptive brand in the States that was unable to advertise for 9 months because they tried to post so many times things about their garments that were helping people, and Meta just denied them. So very frustrating times, and that is a huge example of digital ableism. The other problem being that hate speech within ableism, it's still not seen as hate speech. You know, there are certain words we know not to use in so many other ways. But as some of you may be aware, there is a documentary coming out on Thursday on Channel 4, where unfortunately a very ableist slur word has been put into the title. Should never have been allowed to happen. I don't agree with it, but I can't say too much about that either. But I do recommend to everyone watches that documentary, because it will be impactful. But some of the hate speech that happens to disabled content creators is absolutely intolerable, and there's still nothing being done about it. Then we're going to talk about physical spaces. So I have done pop-up shops, and I think they're a fantastic way for brands to engage with their consumers. But if they can't get changed, why I can't get my consumer into that space? If they can't get into the store in the first place, I can't bring them in there. So it's very difficult for me as an adaptive brand to actually be able to be in physical spaces, because we don't have changing rooms that are accessible, and we don't have doorways and entrances that are accessible. If the lift is out of order and there's only one lift in the whole building, but I was for some reason on the first floor, again, it's a risk that I can't take. So physical spaces are a real problem and something everyone should be aware of. Again, dropped curbs are helpful for wheelchair users, but they're also there for people who've got suitcases, anyone who's traveling, got a buggy, parents. There's so many reasons to make everything accessible to let more people in, because by not letting them in, you're actually saying not only that I don't want you here, but you're denying yourself that reach and those people who want to know about you as much as you will probably hopefully want to know about them. So I'm now going to talk about some of the, I've got four slides of the accessible runways that I've done. So my first ever runway show that I took part of as a part of a collective was in February 2022. And I didn't organize it, so I wasn't the best access in the world, because it was done in a beautiful old church. Church is famously not very accessible. So there were huge steps. Actually, any of the disabled guests had to go around the back and through the changing room with all the models to actually get into their seats. And then they couldn't use the disabled bathroom because all the photographers were in front of it. So not perfect, but getting there. Then I flew out to Nashville the day that the Queen died. And I was meant to have my solo show that in September and withheld it from that because I wanted the models to feel safe to actually travel around London, which I didn't think it would be on a weekend where the whole country was coming to London. And this one was Fashion is for Everybody, which I agree with so much with their ethos. They don't just have people with disabilities and chronic health conditions. They have everybody across every sort of demographic that there is, which I think is wonderful. But personally, for me and what I've done with Unhidden, and this was Runway of Dreams, which only has disabled people the same as me. Personally, I think non-disabled models get all the work. Currently, they have jobs, they get paid, well, not famously, not very well, but they do get paid more so than disabled models do. There's not very many disabled people that have an agency maybe as a representative, and I think it's really, really important that we start to consider paying people with disabilities for their time, because unfortunately, the amount of disabled models I know that have worked for me and then gone on and been invited to do other things with the assumption that they weren't paid, or that it was somehow they were doing it as charity, it's terrible. Like, we know no one should work for free, non-disabled or otherwise, but there is a huge problem with not paying disabled models. I know every model there was paid, and I know for mine that I had overpaid. So these are a few snapshots from my show in February. We had quite a lot of wonderful press coverage, which was really exciting. I had 29 models across age, ethnicity, size, ability, sexuality and gender, to prove that it can be done, basically. If I can do it as a small brand with, at this point, I didn't have a team, I've literally only just started having a team to help. If I, as one person, can do something like that, I don't think that there's any excuse for bigger brands to not be doing it themselves as well. And I think there has been a real trend, unfortunately, for doing it once. It's a tick box exercise, and you never see it again. As a bit of an example, I hope they're not here, but Burberry made a big song and dance about having one amputee model. I don't think they've done anything with her since, but what I know they haven't done is also do adaptive design. So it's all well and good hiring models with disabilities, but then I've seen Boohoo put them in a jumpsuit. A wheelchair user in a jumpsuit, famously a terrible idea, you know, especially if it's not one that's been adaptively designed. And then we come to, if I haven't convinced you of the social impact so far of why it's important, we should talk about the Purple Pound. So the Purple Pound is the spending power of the disabled community. And it is worth $18 trillion globally. And then if you add in carers and friends and family, it goes up to $13 trillion. The UK annual reach, or worth even, is $274 billion. It's not an insignificant number, and yet brands continue to decide not to do this. And that last stat, £267 million a month, the UK high street loses because it doesn't have accessible buildings and it's not offering adaptive products. If for no other reason, you know, we're in a time everyone's looking for growth. It is very capitalist, and I am quite anti that. But at a time when we're looking for growth and new brands are struggling, this is a community that you cannot ignore any longer. And there are being more and more brands that are taking it up. Like Target have their own range now, JCPenney. Tommy Hilfiger is actually doing adaptive design since 2015. They don't really advertise that they do that, but he does do it and he continues to build on that range, which is great. But again, people with disabilities, they don't really want to shop somewhere that's just for them, which is why I try and do universal design. There's nothing to stop anybody wearing this outfit. But sorry, I lost my thread there. Nope, it's gone. I'll come back to it. So people need to be able to get in and to be able to wear these clothing, but okay, I found it. Everyone, we don't all shop in the same place. So it's not fair to expect to sell people to only shop in something just for them. It's very othering. So it's much better for brands to team up with adaptive designers and get us in and help consult and make these ranges built, because the other problem is it's not any good to have non-disabled people design adaptive clothing when they've not studied it, when they don't know anything about it, and when they're not hiring or speaking to people, not just with lived experience of disability, but people with lived experience of adaptive design. And there's not very many of us in the UK. There's about 10 brands. And I think there's more than 100 in the States and about 20 decent ones in Australia, which is great. But there's not enough of us. But hopefully, it continues to grow. And we're seeing it more and more. We're seeing more representation on TV. I think in 2018, Barclays, Lloyds Bank even, did some study on representation in the media. And disabled people made up 0.06% of representation in the media and advertising. So there's a very long way to go. And obviously, since COVID and everything else, like it's getting better, but there's still an awful lot of fear, I think, and stigma. And, yes, disability isn't all sunshine and roses, but it's also, we can do an awful lot more than I think people give us credit for. I look at everything I have done, and also this is not a part to be inspiration porn, because I'm not a fan of that either. But, we can do an awful lot more than we're given credit for. And I think as soon as you bring more people in, you get to learn more. I learn from this community every single day. I cannot speak for a billion people, so I have to bring in other people from the community, otherwise I'm going to get it wrong, and I will get it wrong. Everyone will make mistakes and get things wrong. We all had to hold our hands up after BLM to admit we haven't been doing enough. So I think now is the time we also start to bring that into disability, particularly actually when it comes to disability advocacy. I know, I appreciate I'm sat here as a white woman saying this, but the level of representation for ethnic communities within disability is terrible, given that the medical outcomes are much worse when you add in another intersection of marginalized groups. And it's something that I continue to fight for and make sure that within my hiring practice, within my runways, head of house, everything that we do, that we consider every different intersection again, because you get better results, it's more fun, it's more creative, and it's just the right thing to do, frankly. These are just some lovely comments from people that have bought from Unhidden, one of whom was famously went from non-disabled to disabled, Pete Reed, who is now paralyzed with a T5 spinal injury. And the impact of adaptive design can't be understated. These are just three examples, but I've had people in tears because they hadn't been able to wear clothes that were comfortable, that fit them, that were designed with them in mind. It's something as simple as having a hole in a pocket that someone can feed a tube through. That doesn't really cost you any more to do, and it opens up your clothes to so many more people. And it's just powerful. Everyone here, you all look absolutely fantastic, and you had a choice this morning when you went to your wardrobes. You could look at it, go through, how did you want to feel? How did you want to look? One in four people don't necessarily have that choice, and even just underwear. Underwear they don't have access to, or there might be an adaptive brand, but it's one, and it's Unhidden, but there's... I'm not the only adaptive brand, there are others. But it's still a case of there aren't enough, and the amount of choice everybody else has, we should have that too, because we already have so much taken from us when we are disabled. We have a lot of vulnerability, a lot of moments where we don't get to look or feel our best. But we should have access to that. It's it's something that's kind of a universal right. I should also mention, by the way, I also do very much believe in sustainability. Just realized I've left this off. So I only use dead stock fabric. We have a plastic-free supply chain, and we're also the first adaptive brand to join a fashion rental platform. So we are on Loanhood as well. So all of the show samples have gone onto Loanhood, because price points are something that I still have to work with, because I only believe in paying a living wage to the factory workers in Bulgaria, which means that I will never be fast fashion prices. Even if I was ordering in the thousands, there's, you know, I can't pay them any less by the hour. So it will always cost an amount, but I try and communicate that to my consumers. And I do believe in radical transparency. So I publish on each garment what it costs to get that garment made. Got nothing to hide behind, very honest about it. And I think that's something that I absolutely have the luxury to do as a startup, but I think that's something that other people should consider doing as well, because people respect it then. At least they know that their money is where it's going exactly, even if they can't afford to buy from you still, because 50% of my community are more likely to live in poverty. So I have to be really careful about how I market things and how I talk about price points, because on the one hand, obviously, I want to be able to make it affordable for everybody, but I also don't think that it's right to say to a garment professional, but not your wage. So I'm quite strong on that. And then if you'd like to follow us, that'd be amazing. I don't have a countdown timer, so I might have whizzed through this talk. I have no idea. But if anybody would like to ask any questions, be really, really happy to take any. I think Karen's just going to get a microphone. And finally, a little announcement. I am a on-screen talent for a new show coming out on Channel 4. It airs on Monday. It's called The Unique Boutique. It's at 10 p.m., which is horribly late, and then the next three episodes are at 11 p.m. But that is a show where each week three different people come in who have not been able to go into shops and buy clothes. So it's very much about transforming them. So I really hope that you'll tune in and enjoy that. And if you don't have any questions, if no one's brave enough, it's fine. I'll be here for a little while if anyone does want to come and have a chat. Okay. Thank you all very much, and have a wonderful day.